Hello and welcome to the Weekly Mag. Today we are really happy to have with us the young and renowned sculptor Eudald de Juana. Welcome, Eudald.
Hello, Marcela.
It's great to have you here with us today. Well, Eudald has accepted the challenge to make a work of art live. So, Eudald, you've got a lot of stuff here. Tell us, what are you going to do?
I'm going to do a portrait in clay with just 1 hour, so I will try to do my best. Normally, I spend more time to finish an artwork, but I think with this time I will be able to do a portrait that it looked like a person, at least.
Excellent, that's quite a challenge. Eudald, we'll be back with you later. We'll let you work now, and we'll be back later to see how you transform this block of clay into a work of art. Thank you so much for this challenge, and I'll see you in a bit.
Thank you so much.
We'll have more surprises for you today, and this is just one of them.
Welcome to the Weekly Mag! Today our reporter Humberto was on the prowl for Johnny Depp and his fans. Did he find him? We'll be having a chat with and listening to the cellist and singer Marta Roma. Don't forget to join us for the Crazy Squeeze on TV with Sergi Cervera and many, many more things. This is the Weekly Mag, your TV show in English, hosted by Marcela Topor.
Hello, so let's start today's show with words and facts brought by Mario Serra, Ana Priscila Magrinha, and our reporter Humberto Gonzalez. Welcome all. Hello.
Hey, hello. Hello.
Okay, so you noticed that we have a guest today. He's doing a work of art. His name is Eudald de Juana, a young and renowned sculptor from Navata. He is going to make a work of art live. So tell me, are you guys into sculpture? Are you more into painting or sculpture?
I like observing sculptures. I've never been able to provide the world with a proper sculpture, just like the ashtrays we used to do at school. And then nowadays, I'm guessing they don't ask kids to do ashtrays with with clay.
So. I'm interested in this 3D art. But, the fact is, difference between sculpture and artisan made, like ashtrays or
you're not calling me an artist, I can see that.
I think you are.
I'll show you the ashtray I made when I was seven.
Have you at least ever played with clay?
When I was in fifth grade, during art class, I did do a mushroom that they actually put into the oven, and I still have it at home.
A mushroom?
Yeah, a little mushroom with my initials underneath.
Oh,
it was very easy.
Yeah, sounds good.
But I love your Catalan sculptures. Are fantastic, fantastic. I really love them.
Mm-hmm. Humberto, I thought you were going to talk about the movie Ghost, but you surprised me here.
Anyway, Eudald is working. We'll be able to check his work of art a little bit later, but now let's start the show, because we've got plenty of things today, as well as some mysteries to be solved, like the guest word with Mario Serra.
Of course, we'll have a brand new puzzle, but first we have to remind the last week's puzzle. It was the type of wool you can't pay by credit card. It was an 8-letter word.
Oh.
The type of wool you can't pay by credit card. But you're, if you know it, don't
You're taking it easy on us this time. Right. That's good.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Humberto.
I think maybe he knows, but we have to wait for a
Let's wait, minutes. Let's wait.
Let's wait, okay.
Humberto, a little boy told me that when you heard about Johnny Depp coming to town, coming to Catalonia in Barcelona, you were straight out onto the streets to find him.
Well, you know, that pirate really floats my boat. Hey, Marius, have we used the idiom with the word boat before?
The boat? I don't think so.
I think we need to do that. I'll
take note.
But I have to tell you why I really love Johnny Depp is because he is really, really one of the best actors that I think we've had in our lifetime.
Yeah, sure. That's what you like from him, yeah.
No.
Absolutely.
No. I'm being serious. Every time you see him, he is a different person in every single movie. You take Sally Fields, for example, who's a good actress, but she's always the same person.
Yeah.
Johnny Depp does it completely different. And let me tell you, I went on the lookout for Johnny Depp, and guess what?
Did you get to meet him?
I may have gotten to meet him. I'm not going to tell you yet. Oh. Watch.
Okay.
Johnny Depp is in town, y'all. And La Xarxa doesn't know it, but I'm a professional groupie. And I'm going to do everything I can today to meet that man. Did I not tell you I was going to do everything I could to try to meet that man?
Hola.
Never seen so many people trying to be stalking one movie star here in Catalonia. Oh my God, is this Johnny Depp?
So.
Impressive. I really liked your outfit.
Thank you so much. I worked hard on that.
Yeah, you had a lot of budget for that.
Yes.
So was it Johnny Depp indeed?
Oh, I'm not going to tell you yet. You're going to have to wait and find out for the next little video that I have.
Really? So anyway, what was the occasion?
It was actually the Barcelona Film Festival, and they actually did the premiere of Johnny Depp's new movie.
Okay.
And you would be surprised and shocked at how many fans he had, and what really shocked me, and it makes sense, is that he had fans from all kinds of ages because he does all kinds of different movies. So he does kids movies and he does adult movies. So he had fans. I had kids coming in.
So lots of fans.
Lots of fans. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And but you'll see.
Okay. Anyway, if they are anything like you, Humberto, I'm sure it's going to be a very promising video. Anyway, what's more, Ana Priscila Magrinha has brought us something related to Hollywood stars, right, Ana Priscila?
Yes, since today we have Humberto all excited about Johnny Depp, I will bring you joy and happiness from Hollywood.
Excellent.
Or not.
Well, we'll see. Let's see.
Money, fame, and looks, we think that Hollywood stars have it all, but I'm gonna say another thing about the boat, Humberto. They're in the same boat as the rest of us. Or as we say in Catalan, qui no té un all, Marius?
Té una ceba.
Té una ceba.
Oh, I love that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right.
I must say, I think that when you have money in your pocket, you don't cry so much from onions. I don't know. But with onions or not onions,
not crying.
I will bring you today three actors that have had it all, then they have lost everything,
lost it all.
And then they rose above their ashes.
Wow. Phoenix.
Phoenix. Yeah. Johnny Depp could fit in this list at some point of his life.
Yeah, it's
but
possible.
Let's start with the first actor number one, Drew Barrymore, the sweet Gertie in E.T. We all remember her. Did I pronounce the name right?
Perfect.
Yeah?
It's difficult.
It is difficult, Gertie. We all remember her at age 7 in E.T., the movie, the Steven Spielberg's movie. But she actually had started working when she was 11 months old.
Wow.
I'm guessing not because she wanted to, but no. Her parents, she worked at a dog food commercial.
Yeah,
In a commercial. And from that time on, she kept on working at cinema, commercials, and everything. She could definitely write a novel or two about her life. She actually has written an autobiography called, the title says pretty much it all, Little Girl Lost. Okay, we can see what happens in the book. And she explains that her dad, that he was also an actor, was a violent alcoholic, and her mom, when she had to go to parties, she was like, should I call my friends? No, I'm just gonna take my 8-year-old to the parties.
Oh,
I don't know if you have done this with your kids, take them to wild parties when they were really young.
No, no, they
minus still
me
young.
To their parties. The normal thing is the other way the other around. Way, right? They take you to their parties.
This time was different, so no wonder why she started drinking and smoking really early. She started when she was 9.
Yeah.
Drinking?
Yeah,
smoking.
I knew of that.
But then, one day, she said, I had to get away from my parents, I'm gonna go on my own. And she went
she
back
to... saw a light, a big light.
She saw a light at the end of the tunnel. Yeah. She sobered up and she regained the confidence she needed. She fought back for her career. And nowadays, she's not just an actress. She's also a producer and a director. So, congratulations for her.
Okay.
Actor number two is Mr. Iron Man, Robert Downey Jr.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, again, an actor with more than dubious parents, as I was saying, because Robert tried his first joint at age 6 because his dad gave it to him. What do you do with your kid at age 6?
I'm not taking them to Hollywood.
Let's smoke together.
Yeah.
He has also explained some of his wild days in a book called The New Breed Actors Coming of Age, which is not just him, but other young actors from Hollywood. And he recollects crazy poker games, cocaine, that he said that best cocaine he had ever tried was with Jack Nicholson, heroin, guns, just the perfect mix if you want a disaster. One day he was so high, he went into the wrong house and he ended up sleeping at the neighbor's house.
Oh, okay. That's a short story, but by Manuel de Pedrolo.
I see.
He did it. Absolutely. That's a short story, fictional story. The man coming back to his house and taking the neighbor's house with the neighbor's wife and all that. Yeah.
Maybe Robert Downey Jr.
copied it.
Red Pedrolo. I don't
he wanted to emulate him.
Yeah.
Okay. He was a disaster. Nobody wanted to hire him because all the insurance companies in Hollywood said he's not reliable. Mm. And he ended up in jail. Well, a horrible story. Yeah.
But now he's doing great, right?
Now he's doing great because he has a lot of good friends in Hollywood, like Sean Penn, Dennis Quaid, Mel Gibson. And he got a second chance. He's not just doing great. He's one of the best paid actors in Hollywood. So. Hooray!
Hooray for Hollywood.
Well, we certainly loved him in Sherlock. I don't know if you've seen the series.
Yeah.
No, I haven't. Yep.
It was really good.
Really good.
Actually, the series or the film? The film.
The film, but I don't know if there's more than one film, so maybe that's why.
Maybe it's a series of films, but not a TV.
There's series also.
That's right. Well, we are really happy that he's back on the right track.
And let's talk about the third actor, and in this case, it's a different story, but it's also a dark story. Today, we're getting really dark.
Is it Britney Spears?
It's not Britney Spears.
I think the list is so long, you know?
Yeah.
It is really long. Actor number three is actually Charlize Theron.
Ooh.
And she's not on the list because she has had any substance abuse problems. She hasn't. But she has if we go back on time, she had a really difficult time growing up because she had a violent and drunken father. Mm. And when she was 15, her dad got in at home with a gun.
What? I didn't know this.
Oh, you're going to like it.
Well, I knew something involving guns and violence.
It's awful. It's awful.
Yeah.
Her mom and her were at home. The dad gets in at the house with a gun. They get locked up in the toilet, just pushing the door so he doesn't get in. He shots the gun 3 times at the door. Luckily, or miraculously, none of them get shot.
Not the target.
And the mom finally gets out, shots him, and kills him in front of her.
I did not know this.
This is like a
15.
Film, right? It's
it is.
When life beats fiction, as they say.
I did not know this.
Absolutely.
It is
I'm
true.
Shocked.
And she says that, Charlize Theron always says that her mom is her hero. No wonder why.
Yeah.
Well, let me change the subject for a second.
Yeah.
As you know, we have with us today the sculptor Eudald de Juana, who is creating life. He's making a sculpture life. So let's see how it's going. So Eudald, how is it going? What are you doing? Is everything all right?
Hey, Marcela. Yes, going very well. I'm doing the blocking of the sculpture. Maybe I can show you here. Just the big volumes and drawing a center line to keep the symmetry and keep the proportions very simple, but everything under control. It's just the beginning.
Excellent. We are really looking forward for the final result. What do you think?
It's looking really good.
Wow.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah, totally.
He's a work of art. I mean, that's a work of art.
Thank you.
Yes, you mean.
Are you surprised?
Yeah, wasn't it?
Well, anyway, I really recommend that you stay for the interview and, of course, our viewers, and I'm sure you'll like it very much. Right, well, he's just started, so we'll let him work a little bit more. And now it's time for Mario Serra and the idioms. He will reveal the secrets of some English expressions, and these ones in particular.
Okay, so an idiom that I like is one that says to cost an arm and a leg, and it means that something is very expensive.
The idiom that I like is one that I have used sometimes. It's a friend in need is a friend indeed. And I love it because I think it's true. When you need a friend, you know your friends when you need them.
Yeah.
Okay. I agree too.
We start with the arm and leg. Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe thinking about kidneys.
Yeah.
Está un ruñó
in Catalan.
An eye, for instance. Some different parts of the body. But this, its origin involves a legend. Okay. Because it was said that in old times, painters had different prices for making portraits showing both legs and both arms, meaning bigger.
No
portrait.
Way.
Yeah.
Ah.
It was said, some paintings of George Washington show him standing behind the desk with only one arm behind his back, but this is false. Oh, debunking things.
I was liking it.
In fact, after American Civil War, Congress enacted a special pension for soldiers who had lost both an arm and a leg. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this idiom, this phrase, to cost an arm and a leg, started and was first documented in 1901 in a newspaper, in American newspaper, talking about accidents or injuries, war mm-hmm. injuries. No way of prices of portraits. But it was nice.
And interesting. Idea. And interesting too. But I'm sure you know more expressions with arms and legs. Right?
Of course. Oh, we all have. But for instance, I'll give my right arm for you, Marcella.
Thank
In
you.
In Catalan, maybe, with, I don't know if say our right hand, maybe more than
the arm.
The whole arm.
Yeah.
Or I don't know.
You know, we are always a little bit stingy.
Yeah.
So we're just going to give a hand.
Yeah, that's the hand. Okay. Or to be on your last legs.
Yeah, that one we use.
Yeah, being about to collapse, right?
Oh, okay.
The last legs.
Or break a leg.
Oh, yeah. That
good one.
We talk about
good
that one. At the theater, right?
Or yes.
Having good luck, break a leg, which is quite antonym, right?
I wonder where that came from.
Yeah.
We'll have to research that one.
Yeah, homework for next time.
But let's play a little bit.
Okay, I'm
ready. Oh,
I love
gosh.
Games.
Yeah.
I love
oh,
games.
God.
Yeah,
okay.
Me too.
Give it to us.
With other parts of the body, which is very nice always. Okay. I'll say the limb.
Play head and shoulders, guess. Knees and toes, right?
Well, you have to guess an idiom, or maybe if you know an idiom, with this limb. First, I'll give you five, right? First, wing. With a wing. Any idioms with wings?
You are the wings beneath...
Wings.
No, you're the wind beneath my wings.
Wow! Nice!
What does that mean?
You lift me up.
Oh, okay. Oh,
the nice. Wind beneath my... Oh, that...
Yeah, it was a song, actually, also.
Wow. Uh-huh. Interesting.
Yeah, the only thing I can think of is flying on the wings of love, but that's a song.
That's
yeah.
a song.
I wanted to say the same as Ana Pris and Humberto, so...
Yeah, there was another one under her wings, to be under the wings
exactly.
of somebody,
right.
maybe, if you are protecting someone. Yeah.
Ooh,
right.
I know another one, wing it.
What does it mean?
Wing it. Wing it means For example, you don't know your lines. When you're an actor, wing it means make up something.
Like improvising.
Improvise.
Yeah. Improvise. Yeah. Improvise.
Wing it.
Wing it. Yes.
Okay. Oh, nice. Another one. Head and shoulders.
Head and shoulders.
Knees and toes.
What did you say?
Knees and toes, knees like and that toes? Game for children. You know?
Head and shoulders.
Song.
I don't know that one either.
That's a song
okay.
for us.
More homework for
yes.
you.
Yes.
To study English.
Like
head,
this.
Shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes.
Oh, I know that one, but we say something different. Wait. Yeah.
But head and shoulders means a great amount of something.
Okay.
We don't use biggest. That one.
Don't?
No, that might maybe be a British thing.
Maybe it's British, right? Okay. With neck, for instance. Anyone with neck?
Yeah, yeah, with neck we have some, like, I'm up to my neck in work.
Oh, nice. Good, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like Zalcoli. Snowed yeah. in, right? Like, snowed. Snowed
like
under.
Yeah, I'm snowed under. That's same as I'm up to my neck in yeah. Work. The
snowed
same
under.
Thing. Yeah.
Yeah. In Catalan, exactly. I'm like Walcoll.
I'm like Walcoll. That's the same idea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
From the or to be neck and neck.
Yeah.
Very
even.
Very close.
Very close.
Like even, even oh, yeah. neck and neck. Like in sports, for instance.
Ah, okay.
Right?
Interesting.
Fourth one, foot.
Anyone with ooh, foot? I put my foot in my mouth.
Wow! That's
oh, put your
pretty quick.
Yeah.
You put your feet in it. Is it?
It's foot.
It's foot. You put foot. Your foot, foot in it. Yeah.
Or when okay. you are very, 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 really tired, you just drag your feet.
You drag okay. your feet.
Yeah.
Drag your feet.
And last one, and last one, just limb. Limb? Anyone?
Limb. Oh, I'm going to tear you limb from limb.
Wow.
That means that you did something wrong. I'm going to tear you limb from limb.
Limb from limb.
Parents usually tell
okay.
the kids.
Okay. Uh-huh.
I had one that was
sounds
risk
dangerous,
life
right?
and limb.
Okay.
What is it?
To risk life and limb.
Oh, I don't know
I
that
found.
One.
Meaning like, to take a dangerous risk, ooh. Right? Like very...
Okay.
Okay.
Well, that might be a British
that's nice,
one.
Interesting. Honestly. British, British.
It might be British.
British people.
It's funny, when
yeah,
you don't
Matthew
say
here.
Something, you don't know anything, you're like, yeah, that British. Might be British.
Or Matthew says, that might be Australian.
I don't know that one. Exactly, that's a good one.
Yeah.
That's a nice excuse, right?
Okay,
let's leave limbs aside and talk about
the, other,
the
one.
Other expression. A friend in need is a friend indeed. This one I like very much.
Yeah.
And I totally agree. I totally agree.
Yeah, me too, but it's a... A quite complex proverb because it's a very open. First of all, it's based on homophonic and semantic wordplay. First question, is it indeed one word or indeed two words, right? And secondly, is it a friend when you are in need or a friend who is in need?
Oh my God.
So there are four possibilities of okay. interpretation. First one, a friend when you are in need is indeed a true friend. Indeed, together,
yeah.
right? Second one, a friend when you are in need is someone who is prepared to act to show it. Indeed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Third one, a friend who is in need is indeed a true friend. Indeed. And fourth one, a friend who is in need is someone who is prepared to act to show it. Indeed, which one do you prefer?
I'm in need of a drink after this.
I was going to say, we were talking about joints before and alcohol. Maybe I need a joint now to understand all of this.
There's too many.
Okay, I
dream
yeah.
about this.
I go for the first one.
I go for the first one, too.
I think so.
I don't remember any. I go for the first one, too.
A, number A, a friend when you are in need is indeed a true friend, which is the idea that I think that you said you agree.
Yes.
When you need help,
that's it.
Right? When you need help, and you ask for help, yeah. right?
That's it.
A true friend will help you.
So
right?
now
give you a hand.
We all are true friends because we help to understand this idiom, right? Which is quite complex.
Yeah.
Yeah, indeed. Okay, please wait a second because we need to go back to Eudal because he is about to do something important in his creation. He's reached, I think, a very interesting point. So let's see how is going, Eudald.
I'm working a little bit more detail. It's still simple, but main features start to be in place, center line, and then I try to keep these proportions, three proportions that they are very similar. And then the position of the eyes, I normally think of three spaces, five spaces, which would be the eyes, the space between the eyes, and the space between the eyes and the outer corner of the contour of the face. And just keep playing around. The ears are still very blocky. And also going into the profile sometimes. Profile is really important to keep the main direction of the big planes to see if we want a more pointy nose or something okay. A bit more like deep, strong mm-hmm. face, something like this.
Yeah, thank you, Eudald. We'll let you finish or, I don't know, continue your work.
Yes.
And we'll be back with you in a while.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's go back to Johnny Depp and solve this mystery.
Okay, well, first, how do you like how I recreated your scenes when I used to...
You're really good.
You.
You're much
was
better
that good?
Than me.
Yeah. So, I have to tell you, I was really, really impressed. I did not realize that Catalonia had a Catalan, Johnny Depp, y'all. I was shocked to see...
Well, you'd be surprised.
He looks more like Johnny Depp than Johnny Depp does.
And Joanette Depp.
Joanette Depp.
What's his name, actually?
His name is Bernat. You know, I can't remember his real last name. I call him
Bernat. Okay, Bernat.
On Instagram, it's Bernie Depp.
Bernie Depp.
And he actually has... met, I think, Johnny Depp before, and he was telling me, we exchanged numbers, and he texted me what happened after Johnny Depp arrived, because Johnny Depp was 1 hour late when he arrived, and I could not wait for him, but
that's great,
because I had other things to do, you
oh,
know.
This was really nice.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's not serious,
of course.
1 hour
but,
waiting.
But Bernat Depp, had tickets to get into the movie that the new movie that Johnny Depp was premiering. Mm-hmm. And he said that Johnny Depp gave a 10-minute presentation and recognized him from the audience because he was sitting, Bernat Depp was sitting on the sixth row, and he said that Johnny Depp recognized him and waved at him from the audience. But now, not only did Johnny Depp's doppelganger shocked me, but the fans shocked me as well. Take a look at this.
Okay.
I think this is Johnny Depp.
I'm sorry. I want to be Johnny Depp, but I'm not Johnny Depp.
Are you Jack Sparrow?
I'm not going to tell you. Has anybody done anything strange thinking that you are Johnny Depp?
A woman won't pay me for go to...
bed with her.
For go to eat, nothing more. Okay. I say always no, because I'm not a gigolo. Before I want to be a gigolo, but now. In the airport of Stuttgart, everybody say, hey, Johnny Depp is here, why? Everybody go to me, and I go to the toilet, and I close the toilet, and the police come and take out the people and bring me out of the airport.
What would you ask Johnny Depp if you saw him?
Would you like to have dinner with me tonight?
That's what they ask him all the time.
That's a good fake Johnny Depp. I saw him this afternoon. I knew it, good doppelganger.
Have you ever been a fan of somebody and done something crazy to meet them?
I was very much in love with John Travolta, and I wrote him letters. I even traveled to LA to actually meet him. I didn't get anywhere.
God, that is a fan, that is a fan.
Big fan.
I still want to meet the real Johnny Depp, and I am not done with this mission.
There's some people that has been here like 4 hours or so.
Can you recreate a scene from Pirates of the Caribbean?
Oh, Jack Sparrow, you're the worst pirate I've ever heard about.
But you've heard about me.
Are these flowers for Johnny Depp?
They are flowers for Johnny Depp. I feel that right now he needs a bit of bright colors in his life, so I'm doing my best to help him.
Which kind of plant?
Rosé. Oh no, that's the wine he likes.
What do you have?
Double checking if I can find Johnny Depp's number somewhere.
Oh, and what are those? Are those tickets to get inside?
Yeah, it seems that on the ticket you can find the number of Johnny Depp.
Really?
Te lo juro.
Would you have an affair with Johnny?
Of course.
Of course.
Of course.
Okay, I guess I'll have an affair with Johnny too. Do you know that I was just talking to Johnny Depp a little while ago?
Yeah.
There, do you see him?
Wow. Can you have fun on me?
Not him.
Who would you stalk?
I'm a very big fan of Johnny Depp, so Johnny Depp.
And what does the rose say?
I made it for you. If you want, I call me.
Johnny Depp, Johnny Depp! These people were ahead of the show, ladies and gentlemen. They got his signature already this afternoon. Hi, Johnny.
For you, Johnny.
Olé. Johnny.
Many ways, Johnny Depp.
Oh my God, ladies and gentlemen, I've never seen so much emotion, so much of a crowd. Everybody is just talking and wanting to see who?
Johnny.
Wow.
Excellent, excellent. Maybe you didn't meet Johnny Depp, but you ended up in good company.
I really did, especially there was this one reporter, because I did try, Marcella, to get backstage. I mean, I tried my best. I met this
reporter. So you did.
Well, I'm not as young as I used to be. I think I was more daring in my...
Really?
Yes, yes. But I met this reporter and I said, this reporter looks like he knows what he's doing. Miquel Claudie Lopez from Cinemoteca. He had the phone number of somebody inside the car with Johnny Depp. He was able to tell me it was a black Audi, that when he was coming and everything else. And I, of course, Johnny Depp kept delaying everything, but he was really interesting. And we almost did get backstage because of him. And then did you
almost.
Did you see that guy with all the tickets?
Yeah.
Okay, he was trying to search through those tickets because he thought he could find Johnny Depp's real cell phone number there.
I didn't understand.
Amazing.
Yeah, I was a big groupie when I was younger, and I saw the Go-Go's backstage. I sneaked in to see the Go-Go's. Crystal Gale was another one. I made this huge sign. It was so big that it was about maybe from here to where, 100 meters, let's say.
100 meters?
Yeah, wow. I think it was big. I don't know what meters are. For me, it's
100 meters is
big.
Quite a
okay,
lot.
How much
100
is it?
Meters is
how much
like
is it from here to over there where that ladder
10 meters.
10 meters, okay, yeah. Sorry. My meters are really off. I still use feet. So so it said, Crystal, please let me have my picture taken with you.
Uh-huh.
And she pointed at it during the concert. And after the concert, I went up to the stage and somebody said, come on, you're getting to meet Crystal Gale.
Nice.
Wow.
And, yeah.
Excellent.
But with the Go-Go's, I lost a friend over it. Because I told her to wait in the car, and 3 hours later, I was still partying with the Go-Go's.
Oh.
So,
okay. Oh, amazing, Humberto, as usual. That was awesome. Anyway. Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, after Hollywood stars, fans, and limbs, let's go to the solution of last week's enigma.
Oh, yeah. For all those who have been trying hard to crack it, time's up now.
Okay.
I admit it was a little bit elaborate, but maybe Humberto got it, maybe you.
You know I didn't.
The type of wool you can't pay by credit card.
Okay,
eight letters,
I know it, but...
You know it?
Yeah. What about you? No? Okay.
I'll let you.
It's because it's... I think it's right because it starts with cash.
Yeah.
It's cashmere.
Ah!
Makes
cashmere.
Sense.
That's cashmere.
Yeah. Makes sense. Cashmere.
Yeah, but you have to separate in two words because it's a mere. In other words, cash only.
Right.
Mere cash.
Good one.
Okay.
How did
good
you
one.
Expect me
okay.
to know that?
Because you pay just by credit card, never cash. Yeah. I know. Okay.
Okay.
The next
what
one.
What about next week? Is it difficult?
I think so, but it's shorter.
It's shorter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here's the clue. Magnitudes of a former shelter. Six letters. Magnitudes of a former shelter. Six letters.
Umberto, thank you so much. Ana Priscila, Marius, thank you and see you next time.
See ya.
Okay, but before that, we'll continue with our recommendations. A book and a film that you can borrow from the Xarxa de Bibliotecas Municipales of the Diputació de Barcelona. Our librarian Salvador Faure is going to tempt us with a short novel by Doris Lessing. And our cinema journalist Miquel López from Televisió de Badalona will recommend a film adaptation from a shocking true story. Please check them out.
The
The Fifth Child is a very good novel by Zimbabwean-British author Doris Lessing. The story is that of Harriet and David, who are a traditional couple who marry in London in the 1960s at a time when everybody wanted to attend music festivals and be a hippie. Still, their traditional values make them find a house in the metropolitan area. They get married and they have many sons and daughters. The problem comes only when they have their fifth child, Ben, because he's extremely problematic and highly dysfunctional. I won't tell you why. You have to read it.
A free black man from New York is kidnapped by two con men and sold as a slave in 1841. He is put to work in different plantations in Louisiana for 12 years before being released. Well, this is the real story of a man who wrote a book about his experiences. And this is what 12 Years a Slave, a 2013 Oscar-winning movie, was based on. And this is what inspires us, because the story of this man tells us what to do when you lose your freedom and when you are treated like a dog, or worse. Well, this film was directed by a black man, Steve McQueen, and produced by Brad Pitt, who also appears as an actor, along with Michael Fassbender, Benedict Cumberbatch, and the two main stars, Chiwetel Ejiofor and Lupita Ndongo, who, by the way, won an Oscar for her performance.
Welcome back. We'll be talking in a moment with the sculptor Eudald de Juana and asking him about his work. This will be after we visit one of the most important archaeological sites in Catalonia, Empúries, where the history of both the Greek and the Roman civilizations coexist. We'll be taking a close look at these two cultures with Maria Rizzolo, an Italian guide who has a strong connection with the history of this amazing place.
Hi, we are at Rinas d'Empúries, and I'm Maria Rizzolo. These are the ruins of an old town founded by the Greeks 27 centuries ago in a stunning area of the Costa Brava in the Empordà region. And this is my favorite place in Catalonia. I discovered Empúries as soon as I arrived at Barcelona 17 years ago. I used to live in Barcelona in the beginning, and people explained to me about the Olympic Games that took place in 1992. And I remember being impressed by the fact that the Olympic flames arrived at Empúries, because this was the exact spot where the Greek ships docked. I felt that it was really special. It was like a gateway for a new civilization to the Iberian Peninsula. Like, these ruins are quite special. Well, actually, they are unique in Spain, because this is the only Greek town found so far in the Iberian Peninsula, where there are actually two cities. The Greek one, named Emporion by the Greeks, Emporion meaning market, it was founded in the 6th century before Christ. 4 centuries later, Romans arrived here at the same place, but for a very different reason, a military reason, war. They were fighting the Second Punic War, and then they built a new city, Emporiae, and it was when the Romans Romanized the place, so everybody ended up speaking Latin and following the Roman laws. And they didn't stop here. It was the starting point of their conquest of the whole peninsula. Greeks were traders. They were interested in increasing their commercial area. Romans were conquerors. They didn't stop here. And Greeks respected, there was a very respectful coexistence with the local people. Romans tended to colonize. there was a temple dedicated to Asclepius. Asclepius was a demigod. Asclepius' symbol is a stick with two snakes wrapped around it. And this is one of the 10 biggest sculptures of ancient Greece. So it's very important. It tells a lot of the richness because they could buy such a huge sculpture from Greece and bring it here. Well, mosaics are really special here in Ampurias, but the most famous mosaic of Ampurias is preserved in the museum, and it's called the Sacrifice of Iphigenia. It's a very complex and detailed mosaic. It's like a painting, actually. So the Golden Age, it was when the Romans arrived, a lot of different influences. But then at the more or less first century after Christ, this city entered at a time of decay, because in the meantime, Romans had founded new cities along Via Augusta, this long road connecting Rome to the south of Spain, Gerunda, Barquino, Tarraco. So Ampurias, by the sea, started to lose its importance.
Well, Ampurias is indeed an exceptional place and also not very far away from the home of our guest today, Eudald de Juana. You are from Navata.
Yes.
In Alampurda, yes. Near Ampurias also. Yes. Your work is very much based on the human figure, right? What do you think about the Greek and Roman sculpture?
Well, when I see it sometimes in museums, it's hard to believe, no, that some of the sculptures, they are the way the they are completed, no? This feeling of perfection of form, it's really powerful. I have to say that this type of sculpture is more based on simplicity, and the one I'm trying to pursue it's, it goes a bit more with naturalistic way. But I love seeing it, no? And it inspires me so much, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's talk about your work today. You accepted the challenge of creating a work of art live during our show, which is amazing. We really appreciate it. Mm. So tell us, what do we have here?
So we have a portrait, what I managed to do in this short time.
You managed to do quite a lot, I think.
Yes.
Because usually, how long does it take for you to finish a work of art? Like the minimum time you need?
Yes, look, the more I know, the more time I spend with sculptures, because I become more strict, no, more rigorous, and there is always something that doesn't work, so I try to look, okay, to solve it. So. But normally, yes, in 1 hour I can put the volume, but then maybe I spend days moving things around.
Yeah, it's amazing. So tell us more about this work of art. What's the idea behind it?
Well, I don't know if I would call it work of art yet.
For me, it is. I couldn't do that in such a short time. So
it's just, I look for a general face, and then I start to play with the textures of the clay, which I think they are very appealing. The clay have the nature of clay. It's really like something that feels very alive.
Okay.
When you can see the fingerprints, you can see the marks of the tools. This I really like to show it in my work.
Mm-hmm. Do you think you can work on it while we talk?
Yes, yeah? Of course. I will continue.
Right. Let me ask you about your beginnings. I know that you come from a family of artists, ceramists, painters. You studied abroad. You went to Florence. You spent a few years there. But how did it all start for you?
When I was a kid, I used to draw a lot, and I like it a lot, and I was very good at it. But I was always doing a lot of sport. And it was not until I was 16 that I started to do some drawing classes in the school. That then I reconnected with this passion, and And it was great feeling because the sport, I wanted to be a professional, but it was really hard for me to keep improving. Like it, I needed a lot of effort for improving. But while I was sculpting or drawing, every sculpture, every drawing, it was much better than the last one. And this made me feel so good, this feeling of going further.
And confidence, right?
Yes.
I know that you think that you consider that confidence is the key in succeeding.
Yes.
And it doesn't happen to everybody, right?
Yes. And I think I was so lucky to be confident because a few years ago, when I would look at my works, I would think, wow, they are good. You have to keep doing this. But now maybe I look back and I don't think they are good. But luckily I was, I didn't have knowledge enough to see that they were not as good. So I felt very confident, and this is what pushed me to improve every day, to keep learning, going to studying abroad, and trying to pursue the level of the masters. Yeah.
Yeah, and your dream,
yes.
Right? I guess Florence was really important in your career. Was that like before and after for you?
Yes, it was important. For me, what I learned, all this knowledge, and then also it connect me with people who is interested in this. So I made my net, departing from there. Now there are a few years already from this experience, so I make more nets and new connections in different ways.
Yes.
But yeah, it was for the knowledge. Also, it helped me with my English as well. And to know people from other places is always very inspiring, yeah.
And then you decided to go back home, to Navata, back to your roots.
Yes.
How does that feel? I mean, how does that feel for you?
Yes, it was in a point that I was in the school and I felt I needed much more space to work. I wanted to make bigger sculptures. I wanted to have different spaces. To store molds, store the sculptures, to work outside when there is sun. So I realized that I needed to go back home and find my roots again. And because I'm a guy that I was living always in the countryside, so for me it's really important to have depth of field, sea space, nature green. So I found a place, very big place, and there I make my studio, and also I have other studios for other artists, guest artists, that they can rent spaces there. Mm-hmm.
You work a lot with clay and resin, is that correct?
Yeah, I always sculpt with clay. I do the first model in clay. Once the sculpture is finished, then I make a silicone mold, and then for the last sculpture, the one that will be shown in a gallery or to a client. This one will be in resin, or it can be in bronze as well.
Okay. What about color? I think it's an interesting topic. It's not very common to see color on a sculpture. I know you're very careful about it. How do you use color, and what do you think it adds up to your art?
I think color can be like the fourth dimension into a sculpture.
Right.
We are not so used to see it because it's difficult. It can be dangerous, like you sculpt the form, trying to put every form in the right position, and then you put color and it distracts all the work you did before. But as I think if you can like put them together well, it can attract people in a different way, because once I was seeing in internet, there was some people it's driven by color and some people is driven more by shape in the first impact.
Right.
So there was a little exam that you could see what type of people you are. Mm-hmm. So in my, it turns out that I was more driven by color than shape, and I was a sculptor. So it made me think a lot, because when you are walking around the city and you see a black sculpture, I think in general people tend to, okay, just keep going, no? Mm-hmm. But when you see a poster with big colors, our eye goes there.
It is striking indeed.
Yes.
And something else that strikes me about your art, Eudald, is the fact that we often see broken limbs or unfinished parts of the body. What's the idea behind this? Because I think it's, for me, it's very intriguing. I would like you to tell us about it.
Yeah, I think it's a symbolic way of expressing ideas, because in a sculpture, we just have material, solid material. And in real life, we have emotions, we have a smell, we have a wind, we have so many elements. So in sculpture, you just play with volume. So in order to express certain things that you cannot get it just from reality, you need to play with other elements in the sculpture to give this emotion, mm-hmm. no?
Also, you have like finished parts, which are like smooth, and others which are like rougher or unfinished, and you play with that as well, with textures and finished, unfinished, right?
Yeah.
I guess it's the same idea?
Yes, because for me it's so important, the word variety in the sculpture, because I want to make it feel alive, so accidental. So I always play with contrast. A place there is no texture, it's soft, and then strong texture. Big cropping, something more finished and, like, let's say, perfect, no? Mm-hmm. And give the sense that this was made like nothing in 1 minute and it came out like this, but it's more controlled than this.
Yeah.
But going with this idea, no, of variety. Yeah.
Why do you always mention Michael Bly as a great inspiration for you?
Yes.
How has he inspired your art?
Well, I think he was such a talented sculptor, especially in the way that he showed naturalism on the sculpture. When you see his sculptures playing with the light, it really feels nature. Especially you can see it in the way he would make the hair or the eyes, that you, in a sculpture in clay, you don't have hair by hair. So you have to play with the volumes and give the feeling of reality. And I think he was genius with this. No?
What is the most difficult thing for you when you make a portrait like now? What part is the most difficult one? The eyes? Well, I know the answer. Actually, it's the hair, right? But why is the hair so difficult to achieve?
For the same reason I was saying, that how you make feel something that is solid like clay, how do you make it feel that it's soft, that you could touch it and it would goes in, no?
That's
so
right.
You have to play with different rules, which I think once you learn them, it's not as difficult, no? But at the beginning, I think it's a very big struggle, no? Mm-hmm. For me, right now, the most difficult in sculpture, it's composition, not detail. We always have the tendency to go into the detail, make a nice nose, but the more I know, the more I need to step back, look from the distance, and the big elements, they work well together. Okay. This is simple because it's just a portrait, but when I do a big sculpture with other elements, one is big space, the other is small, what the space in between, what if you turn around because there are other views, how it affects,
Is sculpture much more complete than painting, more difficult? And also, why are there so few sculptures at the moment? I think the percentage is like 90% of artists are painters and 10% sculptors. Is that correct?
I didn't know about this percentage, but I believe it because I was studying fine arts and in the academy, and it was always many more painters. I think sculpture, it demands of a lot of equipment, space. You are always carrying material. It's hard in this way. You know?
And more expensive, right?
Yes, especially if you cast in bronze, it is more expensive. Yeah. No? But at the end, you have to do, I think, what you like. If you get excited about this medium, just do it. No, you find your spot. If you work hard in it. Yeah.
Okay, we'll discuss about Eudald de Juana's art and other things as well in a while with our contributor from Televisió de Girona, Georgina Arnau. But before that, we invite you to watch a short language tip with our teacher, Mark Roderick.
Hi, so I imagine everybody loves having a good conversation about the weather, right? Such a topical point of conversation too. Well, today's words are to do with weather forecast or indeed predictions in English, okay? So, the first thing that we need to think about is a spell. And a spell, of course, has nothing to do with Harry Potter or magic or indeed spelling a word out letter by letter. A spell is like a period of time, like a dry spell when there's no rain, or a bright spell when you're lucky enough to see the sun all the time, or unlucky enough to have a wet spell, just like in Ireland where it's raining all the time. Then, if you don't have a spell, you might have something a little bit more unexpected or all of a sudden, such as a wave, okay? It's the middle of winter and suddenly you have a cold wave. And this is when all of the temperature drops below zero. You have maybe a lot of snow, a lot of ice, etc. Or indeed the opposite can happen in the summertime, where you can have a heat wave. And a heat wave brings very, very high temperatures and can cause and create all kinds of havoc on everybody and everything. Then we have the chill factor. And the chill factor refers, of course, to the wind chill factor. This is the wind, the feeling on your skin, okay, of how cold it actually is. It's not the actual physical temperature outside, but with the wind added, you have this sensation that it is a lot colder than it actually is. And if a day is sunny and then all of a sudden a load of clouds come and cover over the sun, we can call this overcast. An overcast day is when, of course, you don't see much of the sun. And finally, we have hail. Now, hail is not even snow, it's not really rain. It's like a mixture of the two things together. It's like frozen rain dropping like ice down on top of you, and it can be really uncomfortable. This can happen especially during a thunderstorm. In fact, I'm not sure what's happening now, but yes. Bye, see you later.
Millions of hearts have been broken just because those words were spoken. I love you.
In a few minutes, we'll be having a chat with the cellist, composer, and singer Marta Roma. So you better stay tuned.
I'll die. So please be true when you say I love you. It's a sin to tell a lie.
We're here today with the sculptor Eudald de Juana. He's about to finish his work of art. Eudald, tell us, how is it going?
It's going well. Now is this a stage where it starts to, you go to the infinite, like every little detail you could spend a lot of time. But I think, well, I'm happy enough for for this time. And so I know that we don't have a lot of time, so I try to look for more expressive touch, something that can be interesting. And
can I ask you something about his expression? He looks a bit sad to me. And I don't know if this is a common feature of your art. I know you're a very optimistic person.
Yeah.
You're very positive, you always smile, you're in a good mood, but your art tends to be a little bit the opposite. Am I right?
Yes, you are completely right. This is an observation that many people did to me.
Yeah, and it's quite striking.
I didn't think of it until a certain point, and I thought, okay, because I guess we all are in so many different moods, no? We are not or happy or angry people, no? We have thousands of levels. But it's a state that I connect when I'm sculpting. Maybe I'm doing a portrait and I start to move the lips up, down, and then there is the point that I feel, okay, this I like it.
All right.
And the eyes, the same thing, this I like it. And then I look at the portrait and it's like, wow, there is a sense of introspection, like looking inside, no?
Mm-hmm.
it comes very natural to me. Yeah.
I think it's a very interesting feature of your work. I wanted to ask you something about your career in general. Now you've been, your works have been shown all over the world, in the UK, US, Italy, Germany, and so on, here in Catalonia, of course. What are the commissions that you are most proud of? What are the works that you are most proud of?
Yes, the last 4 or 5 years, I have been working in 2 main commissions. The first one, it took me almost 3 years. And it's a commission for a company, a movie company from Hong Kong. Okay. That I work with them, I represent the main characters. So they are going to show it in the poster of the movie. Mm-hmm. It's not released yet, so keep the secret.
We won't tell anyone.
Yes. And then the second one, it's a life-size sculpture of representing an angel for the cemetery of Milan. It's a cemetery monumental with full yep. of sculptures. It's considered, how do you say, open museum.
Right.
And it's in the center of the city, and it's mm-hmm. gonna be perfect place. So I'm working on this one, about to finish it.
Mm, excellent. Tell me about the space that you have in Navata. You're very proud of it. It's a very interesting venue. Tell me what happens there, and what's your daily routine there? What do you do there?
This is a...
First of all, what's it called?
Giot Art Space.
Okay.
Yes. So this is a space for creation. The most important thing, we have a lot of space inside and outside, and I like to live by the weather. If today it's sunny, I'm gonna adapt my work in this. If it's raining, I will work outside, but really feel the landscape, no? And the seasons as well. Mm-hmm. And then there are other studios, and as I'm hard worker and I spend a lot of time on my own in my studio, but I'm also a social person. And it didn't fit so well, these two types of ways, no? So this way, the way I mount my studio is so good, because each artist who is working there, they are doing their own projects, and then we have lunch or we have dinner together, okay. So we share our passions or things, commissions, or talk about.
Right.
Yes. So it's.
So it's like an open space for other artists.
Yes.
And what kind of events do you organize there?
I teach workshops there, 2 or 3 times a year. I teach 5-day workshops about sculpture, portrait, torso, and this is the thing that I do the most. But in the future, yes, I want to do exhibitions as well, right. And do open to other type of events with other art type of arts as well, maybe music or dance or, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. All right, because you mentioned the future, let me ask you if you're planning to go back to Italy?
Yes, I will go for sure. I will go mainly as a tourist, because I love the country and I have friends there. I miss them there. But also maybe I plan to teach some workshops there, or of course, if there is a good exhibition to do there, I will go.
Yeah. Right, now let's go to, I want to ask you something very important about Instagram. You're very active on this particular social platform. You have, I think, over 80,000 followers, which is quite a lot for a artist, for a young artist as yourself. So is Instagram your main platform to promote your art?
Yes, yes. It's, I think social media, it helped me so much. I think this was good time for me, because I'm very passionate about my work, but I'm not someone who is going out all the time shouting, I'm here. And so it was a very relaxed way to reach people.
Yep.
Like I make something, I take a picture, I put it there online, people likes it or not like it, but you are not forcing anyone. No, it's there and people takes it. takes it if they want.
Okay.
And yeah.
Well, it it worked because you're very popular on Instagram. And precisely about this, we would like to talk with our collaborator from Televisión de Girona, Georgina Arnau. Well, Georgina,
hi,
please come
hello.
In. Welcome.
How are you? Nice
Great.
To meet you. Well.
Nice to meet you.
Wow, let me say, it looks amazing, right?
Yep, I agree.
Okay, so I heard that you have been talking about your sculptures and, of course, all this world and the wide range of materials you use for your creations.
Yes.
So I have a question for you, because I don't know if you have ever done any photo sculpture or materials with an expiry date.
Like
with food, did you?
Like ephemeral sculpture,
yeah.
You mean?
Yeah. Right. Have you ever done something like this?
Not seriously.
Not seriously.
I guess something, but not. I'm someone who thinks so much about the future, maybe too much.
Mm-hmm.
So I do it with sand sometimes. When I go to the beach, I can do some sculptures with sand, and this I enjoy a lot.
Okay,
yeah.
Sounds amazing. Okay, well, so today I collect some of different foods that have been turned into an artwork. So, Marcella and Odal, you have to guess what kind of food it is made out of.
Really?
This is, yeah,
wow.
this is like a mini quiz, a small quiz
right,
game.
Like a game.
Carl, as our beloved quiz master would say, I will try to do it right. What is it made of? Something like that. I don't know if I did well.
Yeah, this is Sergi.
Yeah, this is Sergi. So, are you ready for the first one?
Yes,
okay,
let's go.
Let's have a look. Okay, here's the first picture.
Wow.
Yes.
What would you say?
I would say fruit.
Okay.
And I would say watermelon.
Watermelon. Marcella, you agree?
I think so. Yeah, looks like it.
Okay.
Not sure though.
We have the solution actually.
Really?
Yeah. We are watching it backwards,
backwards.
Yeah.
Yay.
So, watermelon,
wow, nice.
You are both right.
Excellent. Do you feel inspired, Eudald?
Yes, and I love the gradation of color that gets the sculpture, that the corners get more green and so the transparency is so nice. It gets closer to skin.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Really good.
Impressive.
What is the weirdest material you have ever worked? I mean, you say sand, but is there something that you maybe want to highlight?
No.
Not really.
I'm a very serious person, not trying anything so exciting.
Okay, we have more food. Okay, so let's continue. This is the second one. What do you think this is made out of?
Wow,
again.
Okay, can I say?
Yeah, of course.
Pumpkin.
Pumpkin, okay. Here's the solution, the second one.
Oh, I was wrong.
Yeah, a bit.
Right. What is it? What is it though?
It's a mini world. Zucchini.
Zucchini?
Oh, yeah. Right.
There is an American sculptor called Ray Villafan.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'm pronouncing it well. He does amazing sculptures just with pumpkins. These amazing characters with portraits, like really dramatic. And it's like, if you guys can take a look, it's so, so good.
Well, actually, all these pieces made by Vincenzo Scurucchi, an amazing Italian artist.
Very
if
good.
If you have time, you can have
yes,
a look at
definitely.
Check his Instagram because
so good.
He has an astonishing works. Okay, let's go for the third one. Do we have more time?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, of course. Oh, let's go.
Okay, you go first now, Marcella.
Yeah, Marcella.
Well, this is a combination, right? I think this is the hardest one. It's like a combination of fruit, maybe?
Yeah, it's a fruit.
Like a pineapple, watermelon?
But is it painted?
Yeah, is it painted? Yeah.
Okay, it's painted. So,
yeah.
Apples? No idea, to be honest.
Apples?
I think there are many tricks here, because if you look at the top shape of the fruit, why is it flat if there is the...
You're going far away, I mean...
I think there is something add to it, no?
Okay, here's the sculpting process. So...
Pear, no?
Yeah,
it's
looks like it.
Apples. Yeah. I was right.
Yes, yes. Right.
Okay, now makes sense. The shape on top. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So what's the name of this great artist again, Georgina?
Yeah, Vincenzo Scurucchi. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right.
I think I saw something on Instagram before.
He's actually really popular.
Yes. He's Italian, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is.
And where does he live?
I don't know.
Okay. No. We should visit him.
Yeah.
A bit of homework for you.
Yeah, thank you.
Do you know any other artists, cultures, who do something similar, work with the weird, well, different material?
There is a friend of mine who is a very good sculptor. His name is Aran Weber. Mm-hmm. He did a sculpture with Apple recently on Instagram.
Wow.
He did it in a different way. He peeled the apple in little bits and he built up the face in the same way, like adding pieces. And then the peel, you say? Red one and green, he added in top. And when you look at it, you don't know if it's a painting or a sculpture. It's really interesting.
Wow.
This was, super cool project.
And we've come to the point where we have a surprise for Eudald. It's called the question chain, Eudald. It's a surprise question for you from our last two weeks' guest in this case. It was Luis Foch, former correspondent for La Vanguardia in London. He has a question for you. Have a look.
I am Luis Foch, former correspondent for La Vanguardia in London and a journalist. And my question would be, would you like to spend your time when the pandemic chaos is over, either in a 2 months' time or in a 2 or 3 years' time? Where would you like to live? And would your life change if you had the opportunity to do it?
Well, good question. But I have to say that I'm very fortunate, and this year was a very good year for me. Because in my studio, since I feel I live in the countryside, didn't make a big difference. And I think, of course, I would travel a little bit more. I had travels that I wanted to do because I'm teaching workshops in Brazil, for example. It will take some more time. But yes, maybe tropical Iceland to spend a little bit more time there, but then continue working in my studio. That is what I like to do the most, no? To work with the sculptures.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah, fair enough. Very good answer. And okay, let's go back to the sculpture. Tell us if it is finished or not and what it represents. The final result, and what's the message, if there is a message behind it? Too many
well,
questions,
I'm not
right?
that quick to to find a message for this. It's not finished, but let's see. I don't know how it looks with the camera because I was working with the light on the other side.
Yeah, I think he has to show this year because it's really
The year is a bit more done while I was working with Marcella. Yes, I think when you make a sculpture, you close the eyes. For the viewer, it creates an effect that it goes inside you, no? You see the closed eyes sculpture and then you think, oh, what is this figure thinking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, it creates this effect, mirror effect that I like. But I think it will need a few more days of work to be a finished work, yes. Definitely.
Okay, so I guess we'll have to come and visit you in Nevada
yes,
to see the
of course.
Final result.
You are super invited.
Excellent.
Yes.
It would be great. Well, Eudald, thank you so much for coming today at the Weekly Mag. It's been a pleasure.
Yes, the same. Super pleasure.
Thanks for sharing your art with us and for accepting the challenge of creating a piece of art live.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank
you. Good luck with everything. Thank you, Georgina.
Thanks,
Georgina. See you soon.
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Because you know I'm all about that bass on cello. I'm all about that bass on cello. I'm all about that bass on cello. I'm all about that bass, bass.
Yeah, it's pretty clear. Our next guest today is a first-class Catalan cellist who made her mark in the prestigious Berklee College of Music in Boston, where she completed her education. She has performed on tour around the world. She's also a composer and a vocalist. Her name is Marta Roma, and we're going to find out more things about her today. Welcome, Marta. It's a pleasure.
Thank you for coming.
Well, today you are accompanied by your friend here, your friend musician. Who is he?
We have Anthony da Cruz. He is coming from Brazil. He's a bass player, but he also plays banjo. And yeah, thank you for being here.
Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us. Okay, Marta, let's see. You studied at the Escola Superior de Música de Catalunya, and also we mentioned before the Berklee College of Music in Boston, which is a very, very prestigious institution known all around the world, but you also grew up as a musician in the Dominican Republic, right?
Well, that was after Berklee College of Music. I did an internship there.
Okay.
So that was like 3 months of an internship working in a school, but I grew up here playing music here in my homeland.
Yes.
And then I started traveling.
Of course. You are a musician, you're from Barcelona. And do you think it is important to go abroad in order to have a more fulfilled career?
Yes, for sure. I would recommend it to everyone. It's not just for music, but it's like a personal experience to grow like and learn English, for example, or, you know, and meet people from other cultures and see different realities. That's very important as a person.
Okay. How much time did you spend in Boston?
I was there for 5 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's why your English is so good.
Well, when they saw me, it's like, oh, maybe they thought that I was from the US. But then I was speaking and were like, no, but where are you from? So my accent, it's a little Catalan, but yeah.
Anyway, what was the experience like? I know you had teachers and colleagues who are very important musicians. Mm. Like we said, it's a very prestigious institution. So what was this experience?
Yeah, it was a great opportunity. I auditioned for that and I got a scholarship. It's very important because it's very expensive to go there. But for me, it was amazing because with this instrument here, I was always playing like classical music. But there, they are very open-minded, and I could find and meet other teachers and other students that, you know, that you can play whatever you want, even if it's a classical instrument.
Of course.
So, and yeah, because it's a prestigious place, we had the opportunity to perform with a lot of celebrities in the music scene.
For example?
For example, since Dream Theater, which is a cool band of progressive rock or heavy or whatever, and also John Patitucci, a jazz bass player, Joe Lovano, Alejandro Sanz came there to perform with us. Yeah, a lot of great, great experiences.
Sounds good. Let's talk about your album, which you released about 3 years ago, called Per Sempre.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was my first album, and it's a solo cello voice. It's just me in that album. I also play piano there.
Okay.
And my idea is to feature the cello in a complete way, not just playing a melody, but also playing like a bass player or a guitar, and put it out there as a complete instrument, not just a classical one. That's my kind of a mission in my life, to show that that's an instrument, a very cool instrument that you can play whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
And I specialize in singing and playing, so there.
At the same time, which must be really, really difficult.
Yeah, at the beginning it's like, you need one part of the brain concentrating on the instrument and the other part on the other instrument, like the voice, but it's practicing.
Quite amazing what you're doing.
Tell me
about your style a little bit. I know that you performed with lots of people with lots of different styles. For example, like you said, Alejandro Sanz, Gary Burton, Jarabe de Palo.
Mm-hmm.
So all these people have different styles, but which style do you identify most with?
Yeah, it's very hard for me to say, because what really brought me to Berklee, it was the jazz, the classical jazz. That was my kind of passion. But of course, there I could also discover, I knew a lot of music before, of course, but I could play with other people and other styles. So for me, it's so hard to define
a genre for me, but yeah, jazz, I love it, but I love boleros, I love Brazilian music. I love music, and that's what I say. I play music, and whatever that mm-hmm. means. So.
And sometimes you play, or not sometimes, you often play with your brother,
yeah.
Okay, with Guillermo Roma. Tell me about your relationship and how do you influence each other?
Well, of course, we are singing together since we were born. And we actually were singing a lot in the car with my parents. And
okay,
I think there, we started to kind of get in tune very well, you know, and we are kind of in tune genetically or something like this. And that's why we sound good together.
But you're not twins, right?
No, we are not twins.
Is he older than you?
Yeah, 2 years older than me.
So I guess the pandemic obviously affected you and your career.
Yeah.
But has it been productive in other ways, maybe?
Yeah, you know, at the beginning I had this feeling of, I don't want to be productive. Now it's like, because okay. we felt like, oh, we have to post a lot of videos and perform virtually yeah, for people. Right. But I was a little overwhelmed. But yes, we did. We ended up doing a lot of virtual videos and collaborations with people that are not here. So it's great to connect with other people. And luckily, I'm playing now quite a lot live. So I'm very grateful.
Yeah, indeed. Also, tell me, just before we leave, I know you teach, you like teaching a lot. How mm-hmm. important is teaching in your career?
It's very important for me. I like a lot to combine my performance life with my education.
What do you teach at the moment?
Well, right now I teach different workshops. I'm not in a specific
okay.
place. This year I collaborate with Con Arte Internacional. They bring music to primary schools,
okay.
Especially with the complex ones with lots of immigration. So we try to bring music where it's very difficult for them to find it. And yeah, the role of teaching and using music as a social tool to make this a better world, that's one of my passions too.
Okay, mission. Sounds good. And today, what are you going to perform for us? Because we are really, really looking forward to listening to you.
Yeah, we bring a happy tune. It's not mine. It's a jazz standard, really old. It's okay. called It's a Sin to Tell a Lie. And of course, yeah, you cannot lie. and this song is actually saying that you make sure you don't lie if you say, I love you. I mean, you cannot lie in general, but don't do it if you say, I love you. And it's yeah a very old jazz standard, and we'll perform it cello, banjo, and voice.
Excellent. Well, it's a sin to tell a lie with Marta Roma. I hope you enjoy it. Marta Roma, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much.
Make sure it's true when you say I love you. It's a sin to tell a lie. Millions of hearts have been broken just because those words were spoken. I do, I love you. If you break my heart, I'll die. So please be true when you say I love you. It's a sin to tell a lie. Make sure it's true when you say I love you. It's a sin to tell a lie. Millions of hearts have been broken just because those words were spoken. I love you, oh yes I do, I love you. If you break my heart, I'll die. So please be true. You say, I love you, it's a sin to tell a lie.
after the musical performance, guess what? Exactly, guess what? The craziest and funniest quiz brought by Sergi Cervera.
Welcome back. We are on the home straight, and that means it's quiz time with Sergi Cervera.
Hello!
Hello!
Hello, hello! And welcome to Guess What, by the way, the quiz that jocks your intellectual skills. Probably not the most profitable, but certainly the funniest ones, right?
As always, let's start introducing today's guest contestant, and it turns out that we have with us today Tony Cerda. Great! We are so happy that you're with us again.
Say hello to you. Did you expect a parade or something?
Yeah, I expected much more.
Much more.
Parade, dancers, backup, I don't
you
know.
Feel disappointed?
Well, I think Sergi will do a show, right?
Yeah, we will do a show, yeah, definitely.
A special something just for Tony. But, as you might remember, Tony is a splendid player who, by the way, won last time. But he's also studying to become an actor, and he is a bit into the occult sciences. So, Tony, can you predict the result today?
I'm gonna win. I just saw it. I'm
good one.
Excited to know the answer. I mean, like, if that's the real answer and that's the result.
No, it is.
Result.
It is. I'm gonna win.
It is. Okay, good to know. Then we'll talk about lottery after the show. Well, let's see if this time he can beat our ruthless players. You already know Dr. Matthew Murtha, sir.
Hello.
A hard-boiled maverick, forever banned from entering most casinos and local grocery store. For some reason, I'm sure. And for some other reason, you are not banned to come to this show.
Yeah, I'm glad that you guys still take me back.
But Tony still has to face Wendy Kessler. There you go, our new dangerous player who still doesn't have the rough manners of Matthew, but just give her a few more weeks and she will grow a beard too.
Well, are you sure?
She never said that.
Is that correct, Tony? Can you predict that?
Yes, she's gonna grow a beard.
Let's go for our first round then. 1 point for every right answer. As is traditional in this show, we will begin with some videos for our beloved multiple choice challenge about personal stories.
So today we've asked our victims on the street to tell us real stories about things that happened in classrooms. So let's watch the first video.
10 years ago when I was at school, a friend of mine, she was sitting in her desk. You know, the typical school desk that it's like united with a chair with like a metal arm. You know, and she was just hanging there in the chair and she put her leg in between the metal arm and she just like kind of got stuck there and she couldn't move and the whole class was there watching her.
All right, so her friend got her leg stuck in the desk. I know that the real question is how, but alas, she didn't say that. So the question for you guys is going to be, how did it? And we're gonna give you a few answers to pick the right one. A, they had to cut off the arm of the desk with a saw. B, they pulled her leg off but broke her ankle. And C, they took both her friend and the chair to the hospital.
What was wrong
with the
chair?
Answer is just one of those. Say,
what was wrong with the chair? Is it feeling sick? Why?
They just got stuck together, and you know, a chair and a person cannot hang out together.
That's right. A love that's not respected by any. A man and a chair.
Give time. I mean, with time, things might change. No, it's okay. Nothing to be ashamed of, right, Matthew. Just society needs more time.
They just don't understand.
Yeah, I get it. What's the answer, doctor?
I'm gonna go with A. They cut the chair.
They cut the chair. Okay.
Murders.
What the physicists say to you that the right answer is?
A.
A.
I think A.
Okay.
Okay.
I will go for B, maybe they broke her ankle. And by the way, if you ever have time on YouTube, you can look for videos of adults getting stuck in child swings. That's also very, very, very funny.
That leads the entire show to an entire new topic of conversation, which is, how do you know? Is it one of your activities on your spare time?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, excellent.
Right. Okay, there we go. That's how it ended.
An engineer had to come and cut with a saw the arm, and it was like a drama in class, super fun day.
Okay, so that's how the girl and the desk got divorced. Matthew and Tony got the points. Well done. Well done. Okay. Okay, Tony, you are making
already
us
already winning.
Yeah, exactly. No, but not just that. You are making us believe in your magic powers.
Yeah. He is. Keep believing.
He is.
Now let's go to our second video. Please check it out.
So when I was in high school, I was really good at physics, and I used to help my partners. I was a really good partner also. So I used to help them, and I used to do their exams of physics.
All right, so this girl is publicly admitting that she was cheating in order to help her partners and colleagues and mates. Okay, at school, of course, at high school. What do you think she ended up studying? This is my question for you guys. A, physics. B, psychiatry. And C, law.
Yeah.
Good question.
Yeah, it's not an answer, but I like the way it sounded.
No, somebody that publicly admits to cheating on tests and like help, absolutely a lawyer.
Yeah.
Absolutely a lawyer. Absolutely. How about you, Tony?
Law.
Yeah. Law. Wendy?
Well, no, just to do something different, I'll go for option B. What was
it? It sounds that you are really committed to your choice.
Psychiatry.
Well, otherwise we're the same.
Okay, the same?
Psychiatry. No.
You can go with, I mean, B. It doesn't go against the rules.
Okay,
you go with
C, okay. And B.
We will see what the right answer is then.
Every partner of mine had 10s in their exams. And right now I'm studying law.
That was, of course, the right and obvious answer.
Okay, let's watch our third and last story.
So I was studying at university and I had an exam. And I sent out a Snapchat to my friends saying, waiting on a mate. And it was 6 a.m, really dark. Then I went to my exam, turned off my phone. And 4 hours later, I had so many missed calls and messages.
Okay, many calls in her phone, missed calls and messages, but why? And from whom? Here are the options. And just as a reminder, Tony and Matthew just got all the points and Wendy none.
Repeat it a couple more times.
Exactly.
To rub
just
it in.
Let it sink in.
Yes.
To put some pressure on, to raise the stakes, okay? So here we go. A, her friends texting the answers to the exam. Okay, that's option A. Option B, her mom thinking she'd been kidnapped and was texting for help. And option C, the police, since she had accidentally sent them the message.
The message was waiting on my mate, right?
Uh-huh.
Waiting on my mate. Can that be mistaken for anything?
Not really.
I don't think so.
All right, I go for the mom.
The mom. Okay.
Me too, because it's funny.
It's funny. Okay, to text the mom.
I'm gonna say the police. Let's get the cops involved.
Okay. Yeah. Could go wrong, right? Let's check it out then.
Because my mother thought I had been abducted and I was on the M8, a motorway in Ireland.
Okay, so there you go. Next time you use your abbreviations when you are texting your family, be careful, right? And Wendy, welcome to the winning team.
Oh, and Tony.
And Tony, of course.
Yeah.
He got predicted.
Hey, he got them all.
Yeah.
He got them all.
I keep predicting the future.
Don't invite him back.
We will.
Okay, so by the way, if you were abducted and got hold of your phone, who would you call or text first?
I would call my mother and be like, Mom, look, see, somebody does want me.
Good one.
Okay, good one. Tony, by the way, just friendly reminder, is leading today's score with 3 points. But Dr. Matthew Murtha, the bully, is just behind with 2 points. Yeah, why not? 1 point away from Tony. And Wendy's 1 point away from Dr. Matthew Murtha. So we'll see what's gonna happen here. But now, for the second round, 2 points for every right answer. There you go. Mm-hmm.
But that will be very shortly, just after Mark Roderick's language tip. Check it out.
Hi. So, I imagine that most of you have some sort of a first aid kit or a first aid cabinet at home, right? Sure. Well, inside you might have cotton, you might have thermometer, you might have bandages, etc. But what do you do if a small piece of wood, like a splinter, gets stuck in your finger? How do you get that out of there? Well, you head to your first aid kit and you look inside and you'll see a little thing called a tweezers. And a tweezers, of course, is like two little pieces of metal that you squeeze together and you can just pluck or pull that little piece of wood out of your finger. You're left, of course, maybe with a wound. And if the wound is bleeding, you're going to need to sterilize it and clean it up. How do we clean it up? Well, we use hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide, of course, is excellent for sterilization and also, funnily enough, excellent for making your hair go blonde. Yeah, if you put it in your hair, it goes very fair and blonde really fast. And that, of course, is where the expression peroxide blonde comes from. This is a person who has used hydrogen peroxide in their hair excessively, maybe, and it's almost white, peroxide blonde. Then, inside the first aid, of course, it can be missing a plaster. A plaster, of course, is something that you use to cover over the wound. In America, they use the word band-aid. And if you're a child, maybe you like little animals or dinosaurs on your plaster. Now, not everything has to be superficial. Maybe you have like a headache and you don't know what to do. Well, you need to take a painkiller. A painkiller is a tablet, or as the Americans say, a pill, such as an ibuprofen or a paracetamol that you take, drink a little bit of water and hope in a couple of hours that it has passes. Well, I hope that you don't need to use many of these things too often, but if you do, at least you know their names. Have a nice day.
So now we know some more words about weather forecasts, but our quiz result is far from predictable, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, it is. And we have just started, but in our second round, every right answer is worth 2 points.
Mm-hmm. So, Sergio, what have you dreamt up for this round? Any national days that you've based the next round on?
Yeah, but not any national day, but National Receptionist Day in the US, as you are probably aware of.
Of course.
Which I am sure that you know for sure.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. It's something, yeah, unavoidable, right? So today we're going to ask you about famous hotels, both real and fictional.
That's right. We'll read out a clue about a particular famous hotel, and you'll have to use the instruments to be the first to guess the name.
Yeah, you don't have to answer if you have been there already. Here we go. Three, okay. Two, one. Let's go.
So, a luxury hotel in New York whose name is Spanish for square.
Tony? Go for it.
Plaza?
Exactly.
There you well go, done. Well done. Show some more commitment to the answer.
Yeah. Plaza Hotel.
Yeah, no, it's Plaza, isn't it?
Plaza Hotel, that's okay. Right.
Excellent. Absolutely.
I thought this quiz was going to be in English.
Well, it is, most of it.
We're in the speed challenge, Doctor. So, right. Moving forward, this imaginary hotel made into a popular song by the Eagles.
Hotel California.
Job well done. So points to you, Doctor.
Right. A hotel in Washington at the core of the biggest U.S. political scandal.
Doctor?
The Watergate Hotel.
Excellent.
You have to home.
Yeah, I did. This is not working.
But, like, squeeze it hard. All right, next one. This hotel in Vienna gave its name to a delicious chocolate cake. Tony?
Sacher.
Correct. Absolutely. Well done.
Sacher cake. Right.
Good one.
Sacher.
Sacher.
Oh, okay.
Hotel Sacher. Here we go.
A creepy hotel. From
Wendy.
Stanley.
Sorry?
Tony.
A creepy hotel from a Stephen King book was the setting of The Shining.
The Overlook?
Overlook.
Well done!
Yeah.
Well done.
Amazing. But
you know all the answers because you predicted
them.
No,
I like them.
So
I predict them. I predict them, yeah.
Then show more commitment to it. This California motel wouldn't get many stars in TripAdvisor on account of this psycho-killing girl the shower. Yeah, psycho-killing girls in the shower in the...
Motel?
Stanley.
No.
Three, two, one. Time's up! Bates Motel. Hey, Norman Bates, yeah. The killer.
This one was difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, this hotel first created in 1898 in Paris set the standard for luxury hotels around the world.
The Ritz?
Wendy. The Ritz Hotel, well very done. Good.
Point goes to Wendy, there you go. A real Las Vegas hotel where fictional things happened in the hangover. Wendy.
The Palace?
That is not correct.
Well, something with palace, yes.
Something with palace.
Oh, that is not correct. I mean,
Caesar's palace.
Oh yes, yeah.
That's absolutely correct.
That's what I was just thinking about.
Just took me
about.
Three chances.
Yeah, it shouldn't okay. count it, but no. you know, I'll do it.
Right, a small hotel set on the English coast with the most hilarious owner, played by
Tom Cruise. The Fawlty Towers Hotel.
There you yes. go.
Excellent.
Forget the thing with the swings. If you're on YouTube, look at the Fawlty Towers.
Again? Again? Promoting
That's
YouTube?
Right.
Okay, let's move forward. We're on the speed challenge. This luxury hotel is one of the two tallest buildings in Barcelona. Wendy.
Wait, luxury? The Hotel W.
That is not
arts,
correct.
Arts, arts,
doctor. Arts, doctor. Arts. She said arts.
Yeah, art, there you art. Go. There you go. Okay. You should play by the rules, you too.
I was going to say W.
Okay, Wendy got the point. Job well done.
Right, so have you ever stayed in any of these hotels? Or, I mean, the real ones, of course.
I've seen the Plaza in New York. The Plaza
Okay,
hotel.
You've seen it.
From Home Alone, right?
Yeah. Is it where Donald Trump was as well?
Yeah. Right?
Okay, so let's check the score. As Tony predicted, he's leading with 9 points, followed by Dr. Matthew Murtha with 8 points, and Wendy's catching up with 7 points, so a lot of things can change.
Close game. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so don't put away your instruments, guys, because everything will be decided, of course, in the lyrics challenge.
Oh, no.
Okay, so you've all played it. You know what it's all about. We start reading some verses of a popular song, and you have to be the first to play the instrument and guess the song to get 3 points, okay? 3 points. Anything goes. You can say the title, you can say the name of the artist, or you can sing or simply hum the melody.
Yeah.
Tony, absolutely. I know you're very good at singing, so
exactly.
Maybe we can
no pressure.
Listen to you.
No pressure, but just Marcella. Marcella asked you to sing along, basically. You want yeah, okay, to okay. sing the song. Just one thing, use the instruments at your own risk. Because if you get it wrong, or you don't know the answer, we will take 3 points from you.
Okay.
Do you feel threatened?
Yeah.
There you go. That's what I like. Let's start.
Right. This one, I think we start with an easy one. Like.
That's it. That's right. it. Especially okay. because we know the answer, so that's it.
Exactly. Well, today is gonna be the day.
Wendy.
Today is gonna be the day, and I'm da 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 back to you.
Excellent.
Yeah,
it is.
Keep singing. Just
no, it is. I don't and know.
There
what
you
where's
play
the name
the
of the band?
To the points, not just because of singing, but also for her commitment, her attitude singing. That was wonderful, Wendy.
So extra point for attitude?
No, but nice try. We're talking about Wonderwall, one of Oasis' biggest hits. It was sung by Liam Gallagher after Noel made him choose between being the vocalist of Wonderwall or Don't Look Back in Anger. Fun fact.
Right.
Didn't know that.
Okay. Next song, please, Sergio.
Yeah, absolutely. Hmm? Big wheels.
Keep on turning.
Ah. Keep singing.
I'm rolling.
No, oh, no, no, don't mess it up. Music. Music before you mess it up.
Oh, yeah, this is what I was saying.
What do I? Look how happy he is.
Oh, buddy.
I just saved your ass, Mr.
Yes,
America.
You did. Yes, you did.
I just did that
well,
for
that's
you.
Totally.
We are talking, of course, about Sweet Home Alabama,
Lennon
as
Stone.
You knew, as you
know,
wanted
yeah.
to say. Mm-hmm. So Dr. Matthew Murtha got the points. This is the song sung by the American rock band
Leonard Skinner.
There you go, you knew it. There you go. Job well
Excellent.
Done.
A very popular song written by Ronnie Van Zant, Gary Russington, and Ed King. And the surprise thing is that none of them was from Alabama, in case you didn't know.
No, it's disappointing. It is? Who cares, right?
Yeah.
Who cares? They wanted to make a song about Alabama, so just do it. Okay, let's go for the third song. Take it away, Marcella.
Okay, here it goes. I used to think maybe you loved me. Now, baby, I'm sure. And I...
Tony?
And I just can't wait till the day when you knock on my door.
Keep on going!
Wow! Impressive!
Walking on sunshine, whoa!
Louder!
No, yeah. I haven't warmed up.
And then keep singing. Keep singing for your
voice. I'm walking on sunshine, whoa. And don't it feel good?
Music, please! Well done! Yeah, what a great song, right? To cheer you up.
Okay, well. The next song will be very interesting,
it
Sergi.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
So let's listen.
Sergi. Let me take a breath because the lyrics are gonna be complicated, especially
yeah,
for my accent.
Very complicated.
Very, very complicated. Also, we were talking about Walking on Sunshine by Katrina and the Waves. Job well done, and Tony got the points as he predicted. All right, guys, so here it comes. This is the next song, and the lyrics are gonna be a bit complicated, so just give me some time to get into it. Get ready and here we go. Ladies. 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 Ladies.
I think he's stuck.
Ladies.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you okay?
No, no, I'm okay. I'm just,
we broke.
No, no, yeah. I'm okay. I'm not gonna read. I'm not gonna read. I know my lines. Ladies. Ladies?
No, I think he's having a stroke.
Yeah. Ladies, I'm asking for it. Ladies!
You mean these are the actual lyrics?
Those are the actual,
oh, okay.
Yeah,
so you are okay.
Yeah, I'm okay, yeah.
Okay.
Surrounded by ladies.
I was worried, honestly.
Nothing to be worried, well, maybe some things to be worried about, but not this particular one. Tony?
I'm gonna take a wild guess. Is it ladies? Ladies, ladies.
That was serious. That you did.
Yeah.
You were a good. I mean, you were good at magic.
Yeah, really. I know.
You
I know.
You predicted the whole thing.
How did you know? Anyway, I mean,
I don't know. It was so right. Complicated.
Would you, yeah, yeah. I mean, would you guess the title of it by any chance?
I'm gonna guess ladies.
Ladies.
We can counter it, right? Okay, let's check it out. Play the music, please.
Ladies, 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 ladies. Ladies, 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 ladies.
It's a good song, huh?
Ladies, 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 ladies. Ladies, 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 ladies.
So wait, I feel like this is
exactly. We are talking about Ladies by Fiona Apple.
No way, can't be Ladies.
No, it can't be.
No,
I know the lyrics might be misleading.
Yeah.
Definitely misleading lyrics.
I thought somebody read my mind as I walked down the street because I'm like, ladies, 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 ladies.
No, no one is reading your mind. You are saying that out loud.
Yeah.
And it's creepy.
Oh, right. I need to stop doing that.
Okay, so the song is from Fiona Apple's last year's album, Fetch the Bolt Cutters, which according to Apple is a lot of not letting men pit as girls against each other so they can control the message.
Message understood. Then.
Yeah.
Well clear. Very
yeah,
clear.
Yeah, that wasn't very hard, right?
That wasn't very hard. What is clear, too, is the final score. And yes, we have proven to have somebody with magics here in public.
Yay.
He predicted the result. Aww. He won the contest. He
Yay
got 15
me.
Points, followed by Dr. Matthew Murtha with 11 points. And in a third, but well-deserved
yeah.
and
I'm okay,
charming
yeah.
position, our beloved Wendy.
Very decent.
Yeah, very decent.
Honorable.
I mean, 10 points.
Yeah,
come
it's
on.
Not bad.
Matthew okay. owned this point still from
oh, that's
a couple
true.
Of months ago.
Right, so let's see. We've heard a hit from the 70s, another from the 80s, mm-hmm. a hit from the 90s, and now a very recent song from this century, actually. Which of these decades do you prefer musically, Tony? This is a question for you.
Probably the 90s or the early 2000s. Not the since I'm so young, I wasn't born in the 80s and 70s. So yeah, the 90s, the early 2000s.
So we have a winner, right?
Well, absolutely, yeah. The predicted one.
You
already predicted one.
Congratulations!
Job well done, Tony. I mean, you didn't do that much because you already knew all the answers.
Yeah, I already knew everything. It wasn't hard.
Really? Okay. Go. Let's see. Go. I will believe you if you come another time and the same thing happens. Now I will have to start worrying a little bit.
Yeah. Are you gonna come?
Oh, whenever you invite me.
Are we gonna invite you? Just predict the result.
Yes, yes.
I think so.
Might happen.
All right. Well, Wendy and Matthew, thank you so much. See you next time.
A pleasure,
always.
And with our quiz, we end our show for today. We'll be back next Saturday with a new episode. In the meantime, you can follow us online and don't forget to have a go at cracking the guessword by Mario Serra. The clue is magnitude of a former shelter that's 6 letters. Well, thank you so much for watching. Keep up your English and have a fantastic week. Bye-bye.